On a warm summer afternoon in 2010, 7-year-old Kyle Lewis from Texas spent the day swimming in a local lake with his family. It was supposed to be an ordinary weekend, but 5 days later, Kyle developed a high fever, severe headache, and vomiting. Doctors suspected meningitis, yet the usual treatments did nothing. His condition worsened hour by hour. Soon, he fell into a coma. Scans revealed massive brain swelling, but no bacteria, no virus, nothing that made sense. The truth was terrifying. Kyle had been infected by a microscopic organism found in warm freshwater, Naegleria fowleri, better known as the brain-eating amoeba. It doesn't come from the ocean or some hidden laboratory. It's a free-living microbe that thrives in lakes or rivers, and even poorly treated tap water during the hottest months of the year. When water containing the amoeba enters the nose, it travels along the olfactory nerve straight into the brain. Fewer than 10 people in the world have ever survived this infection. This is not a story about a pandemic or a new virus. It's a story about a tiny organism that kills with almost absolute certainty, silently, invisibly, and within days. This is Naegleria fowleri, the brain-eating amoeba. The story of Naegleria fowleri begins in Adelaide, South Australia, in the mid-1960s. Between 1965 and 1966, doctors were faced with a frightening mystery. A series of children died suddenly from a disease that looked like bacterial meningitis but didn't respond to antibiotics. Autopsies revealed severe brain inflammation, yet no bacteria or viruses were found. Instead, pathologists discovered strange, moving cells inside the brain tissue, unlike anything they had ever seen. Two Australian scientists, Dr. Malcolm Fowler and Dr. Rodney Carter, studied the samples and realized these organisms belonged to a free-living amoeba, one that had never before been known to infect humans. They named it Naegleria fowleri, after German scientist Kurt Naegler and Malcolm Fowler himself. At first, many in the medical community refused to believe that such a simple organism could kill humans. Amoebas were considered harmless pond dwellers, not lethal pathogens. But more cases began appearing, first in Czechoslovakia, then in the United States. Each case told the same story: healthy people, mostly children or young adults, swimming in warm freshwater, suddenly struck by an unknown and fatal brain infection. By the 1970s, scientists confirmed that Naegleria fowleri was widespread, found in lakes, rivers, hot springs, even in poorly chlorinated swimming pools. It didn't live inside hosts like parasites do. Instead, it was a free-living organism, capable of surviving independently in the environment. What made it even more terrifying was its resilience. The amoeba could transform into a cyst, a tough protective form, and survive heat, drought, and even mild disinfection. Once Naegleria fowleri enters through the nose, the countdown begins. The amoeba travels along the olfactory nerve, crossing the thin bone plate that separates the nasal cavity from the brain. Within hours, it reaches the olfactory bulbs, the brain's gateways for smell. From there, it spreads rapidly, feeding on nerve tissue itself. Normally, this pathway is protected, but Naegleria has evolved enzymes that dissolve tissue barriers. Neurons die by the thousands. The immune system floods the brain with white blood cells and inflammatory molecules, but inside the sealed skull, that response only makes things worse. Swelling increases, intracranial pressure builds, and brain tissue begins to compress against the skull. Once inside, it transforms from its harmless trophozoite form into an aggressive predator. The infection is called primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. The first symptoms, headache, fever, nausea, appear 2 to 5 days after exposure, resembling ordinary meningitis. But within hours, confusion sets in. Seizures, hallucinations, loss of balance, coma. Death usually follows within a week. The survival rate is less than 3%. Out of more than 150 recorded cases in the US since the 1960s, only a handful have lived. Most infections end the same way, fast and fatal. But a few stories stand out because they reveal both the horror and the hope. In 2013, a 12-year-old girl named Kali Hardig from Arkansas went swimming at a local water park. Within days, she developed fever, vomiting, and confusion. Doctors diagnosed primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. Her medical team refused to give up. They used an experimental drug called miltefosine, developed for parasitic diseases like leishmaniasis, combined with a cocktail of antifungals and a medically induced coma to protect her brain. Kali survived. she was only the third known survivor in U.S. history. 3 years later, in 2016, Sebastian DeLeon, a 16-year-old from Florida, became the fourth. He fell ill after swimming in a warm lake. Fortunately, the hospital recognized the symptoms early, started miltefosine immediately, and placed him under hypothermia treatment to reduce brain swelling. After weeks of therapy, he walked out of the hospital alive. But for every survivor, dozens die. Kyle Lewis was not the only victim. His story became known because his parents turned their grief into a mission, but through the years, others have faced the same unimaginable loss. That same summer, in Louisiana, 14-year-old Will Matthews began to feel ill just a week after wakeboarding. He was athletic, fearless, and loved every sport, baseball, football, snowboarding, and wakeboarding. When he fell sick, doctors believed it was encephalitis. Within 5 days, he was on life support. In 2013, Zachary Reyna, a 12-year-old from Florida, was playing on a kneeboard with friends in a ditch near his home in LaBelle, Florida. He was a bright, talented boy who loved sports and adventure. A few days later, he started feeling weak and feverish. The infection spread quickly. Zachary's family said he fought like a warrior until the very end. Each story is heartbreakingly similar. Healthy, young lives taken by something invisible, hidden in the water we trust. Even though public health agencies issue warnings every summer, infections continue. Many people still believe it can be caught by drinking contaminated water, but that's a myth. It can only infect through the nose when water is forced upward with enough pressure, as during diving or jumping. Every year, millions swim in warm lakes, rivers, and hot springs. Yet only a few dozen cases of Naegleria fowleri infection are reported worldwide. So why is it so rare, and why do experts fear it's becoming more common? The amoeba thrives in warm, stagnant freshwater between 30 and 46 degrees Celsius. It feeds on bacteria found in sediment and biofilms. When the temperature drops, it forms a hardy cyst waiting for the next heat wave to return. For infection to occur, two coincidences must align. The amoeba must be present and active in the water, and also water must be forced into the nasal cavity, allowing the organism to attach to the olfactory nerve and invade the brain. Drinking contaminated water poses no danger. It's the nasal route that kills. Because these conditions are rare, so are infections. But the pattern is shifting. Warmer summers mean more lakes and rivers now reach the critical temperatures for amoeba growth, even in regions that were once too cold, like the northern United States and southern Europe. Floods and poor water infrastructure in developing countries also spread the organism into domestic supplies. The US CDC recorded cases as far north as Minnesota, a state once considered too cold for Naegleria fowleri. Scientists call this the tropicalization of freshwater ecosystems, a biological marker of climate change. Some people think chlorinated pools are risky. In fact, properly maintained pools are safe. Others believe the amoeba lives in saltwater. It doesn't survive in the ocean. Its true habitat is inland, lakes, rivers, geothermal pools, even poorly disinfected tap water systems. Each summer, as the world gets warmer, that habitat expands. What makes it so deadly isn't just the amoeba's aggression, but the location. In most infections, swelling or pus can drain or be relieved by surgery. But the brain is trapped within bone, there's nowhere for the pressure to go. By the time doctors suspect PAM, the organism has already destroyed vital neural pathways, and diagnosis is nearly impossible in time. Few labs can detect Naegleria fowleri quickly, and its early signs resemble far more common infections. Antifungal drugs like amphotericin B can kill it in vitro, but in living patients, reaching the brain tissue in time is extraordinarily difficult. There have been survivors, a handful worldwide. They were treated with combinations of antifungal and antiparasitic drugs, induced hypothermia, and sheer medical luck. But for most, by the time the diagnosis is made, the damage is irreversible. Since the early 2000s, scientists have been working to understand the amoeba's biology at the molecular level. They discovered that Naegleria has an unusual genetic structure, part amoeba, part flagellate, allowing it to switch forms and survive extreme conditions. It can go dormant in dry soil for months, then come back to life when it touches warm water. Researchers have also identified enzymes and proteins that help it break through the brain's protective barrier the same enzymes that could someday become drug targets. New computational models are being developed to simulate how the parasite moves, attaches, and invades brain cells, all to find weak points in its attack. At the same time, epidemiologists are building heat maps of lakes, rivers, and water systems, tracing where infections happen most. Public health authorities are focusing on prevention. Some states monitor recreational waters in summer, while others install warning signs near warm lakes. The CDC and WHO emphasize awareness. Avoid getting warm fresh water up your nose, especially during diving or swimming. The story of Naegleria is not just about fear, it's about awareness. Early detection and education have already saved lives. Knowing the risks is the best protection we have. It's a microscopic creature with no intent or malice. But its lesson is vast. Nature always has the final word.